Praise the Lord. I want to welcome you all to the Solution Hour this week. This is a new month, and this is the last month of the year 2019. Praise God. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. We bless His name and we adore Him because our God, He is great. Let's have a word of prayers together. Father, we want to praise You and worship You. Thank You for the great and mighty things You have done for us since the beginning of the year. Thank You for what You have made our hands to touch. Thank You for what You have made our eyes to see. Thank You for the food You have given us. Thank You for the protection. Thank You for the sharing. Thank You for the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank You for the presence of the Almighty God in the midst of the church. Thank You for the life of every brother, every sister listening to me today. Thank You for the great and mighty things that You have done for us. Blessed be Your name. We have come to the Solution Hour, the very first week in the last month of the year. Father, we are praying that God, who is real, who is pure, who is great, manifest Yourself and let Your people feel You and know You. We praise You, O God, because You are there for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. We thank God that we have come to December. We praise God for what He has done. All through January to this time, 11 months have gone. It is the power of God that has given us the gift of life. The Bible told us very clearly that life started when God breathed into man and he became a living soul. Do you remember that the coming of Jesus Christ into the world is the emblem, the capping of the gift of life to man? When Jesus came, is the priceless gift of God, is the breath of God that God breathed upon man, and man became a living soul. At this season of the year, many people are confusing the Lord Jesus Christ as one of the heroes that's just born in the world. And sometimes you look at, you know, in some quarters, in some churches, they put on the, you know, image of Mary, or the carving of Mary and Joseph and the calf and the sheep and the lambs and all the things and the shepherd and all the light that came around to him and the baby in the manger. They gave us all that kind of descriptions about Jesus. And all that people know about Jesus is just within that one. Why did he come? They don't know. Who is he? They don't know. And because people don't know him and they don't understand him, they are not having the understanding of what is the real thing. Again, I need to understand. And I want us to understand in this first section of, you know, the first time we are having this solution meeting in the last month of the year. A committee was sent to John the Baptist to ask him the question that, who are you, John? Are you the Messiah? He said, no, I'm not the Messiah. Then, are you that prophet that Moses was talking about, that a prophet like unto me shall the Lord God himself raise for his own children? Are you that prophet? John said, no, I'm not that prophet. Then, are you Elijah? He said, no, Elijah has come and gone. Then who are you? Then John declared unto them who he is. He said, I'm the voice of the king's herald. I'm the one to declare him, because I have known him, they have revealed him to me, and then I'm revealing him to the people. Look at what he said in verse 19 of John chapter 1. John said, now this is the testimony of John when the Jews sent the priests and the Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who are you? Then if you look at verse 33, he declared unto them, he said, I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said unto me, upon whom you will see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Ghost. So in that passage, you see that Jesus was revealed unto John. The revelation of Jesus Christ came outside him. There's no way Jesus could be known to John apart from that revelation coming outside him. So you look at it in this passage. John said very clearly that I did not know him. Historically, I was told about him. And this is the revelation I have about him. I did not know him, but the fellow sent me to baptize with water, said unto me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining. That is the person that I have to send. He's the one that we baptize with the Holy Ghost. So here you see John declaring the knowledge of Christ. He did not know Christ, but God revealed Jesus unto him. Flip back to verse 15 of that John chapter 1. It said, John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me, and of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. You see, in that passage, John was saying, something told me, I have an information. The information came outside of me to reveal this Jesus unto the whole world. And this is the information I have. He is to be preferred before me. He is to come after me. He is preferred before me. For he was before me. Ever before I was, he was. Ever before I existed, he has been existing. Is that not exactly what Jesus Christ said when he told all the Jews? He said, before Abraham was, I am. And they were quarreling and they were unhappy because Jesus has been there all the while. There are many people in this season who have the story of the life of Christ, the story of the work of Christ. They have all those stories and they regard it as just one of the tales. There are millions and millions of people that are comparing the word of Jesus Christ, the activities of Jesus Christ, the miracles of Jesus Christ with that of Shakespeare. And they look at that work as one of the writers of the ancient world. Oh, not at all. Many people are reading the miracles we have in the Bible and they look at what Jesus Christ has done and they relegated that miracle and limited that miracle to a time period. It's a time that Jesus spent on planet Earth. They make it a limited historical time. That the people that Jesus Christ ministered to were no longer alive. And they were even thinking in themselves that that miracle is no longer going to be extended. It has ended with Jesus. And that is the end of the story. And they conclude that that miracle can never be done again today, because they don't really know who Jesus is. Look at it in the Bible. Because at this season, as we are coming to the end of the year, we need to realize one thing. That Jesus is the real thing. The bread that God himself has given is the priceless gift that God has given to the world. Look at what we are told in Matthew chapter 12. I want to read verse 22. Then one was brought to him who was demon-possessed, blind and mute. And he healed him, so that the blind and the mute man both spoke and saw. Look at it now. There was somebody who could not speak. There was somebody who could not see. They brought this man to Jesus Christ and said, "Heal him." And Jesus Christ in his mercy came around and healed the man and delivered the man. And after the deliverance of the man, look at what happened. All the multitude, they were amazed and said, "Could this be the son of David? Is this the one that we are expecting? Is this the predicted Messiah? Is this the chosen of God? Is this the anointed of God?" Now, look at it. When people just have the historical value of Jesus, when people just have just the story, the talking of Jesus, and they don't really understand who this Jesus is, what Jesus can do, how Jesus has come, why he came into the world, they don't have the reality of Jesus. They don't know the real thing. They don't know the real person. They don't know that history is contained in him. History is his story. You are part of the story of Christ because your response to Christ dictates your story. When you respond positively to him, it dictates the story of your life. When you respond negatively to him, it dictates the story of your life. So your story is inculcated into his story. Look at what the Pharisees said. Now when the Pharisees heard that, they said, "This fellow," referring to Jesus, "does not cast out demons except by Beelzebub, the rulers of demons." You see, look at what they are saying now. They zero down, they fantasize the work of Christ, the miracles of Christ. They were thinking this, how it must have been. And then it must be from the devil. It must be from the power of the devil because they don't know the real him. As we are coming to the end of the year, let's take this in our mind. Let's take this in our heart. We need to know the real Jesus is not a fairy tale of a legend. Jesus is not just a hero like we have it in CNN, having the CNN hero. No, Jesus is not just the word hero, not at all. God never intended us to see Jesus Christ as an historical figure. It's far more than that. Jesus is alive today, and through his ministry and the work of the Holy Spirit, he's been transferred. We can be made to understand this is the very Christ, the Son of the living God. So the historical knowledge we have about Jesus, like the historical knowledge that John had, was that made John to know the power of Jesus, the grace of Jesus, the anointing of Jesus, the miracle of Jesus, the grace and the power of God inside Jesus. That very power that was in him, that assisted him, that went with him, that, you know, surrounded him and helped John out to be able to reveal him to the people, is exactly the same thing that God has gone on to run. Historical knowledge should lead us to holistic knowledge of God. What is real? So in our topic, we are looking at know the real. Who is the real? Now, look at the holistic knowledge of Jesus in verse 33. I read it again. John said, "I did not know him. But he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'Upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Ghost. Something told John that now you are endowed with a great knowledge, that anyone that have, you see him having the Spirit of God descending upon him, he is the very Messiah. He is the prophet that Moses spoke about. He is the very son of David. He is the one that has the throne as everlasting throne. He is the one that his word can never fail. He is the one that has the promises that are yea and amen. He is the one that has come to reveal God unto us. He is the one that has come to make God to dwell in us. He is the one that has come to complete the entire work of creation. God created man that man may dwell with God and live with God and abide with God. He is the one that has come to complete the whole thing. He is the one that is both God and man combined. He is the one that has made everything complete in him. That's Jesus. So John was so much endowed by the knowledge of the Holy Spirit that he received concerning Christ. He was so enriched. He was so wealthy in the knowledge of Christ that he declared him to the whole world. Look at what we are told concerning the church in Corinth. That this church in Corinth was so endowed that their utterances, their knowledge, their speaking is full of the richness of the grace of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, we are told that you were enriched in everything by him. You are enriched in everything by him. That is the knowledge that you know of Christ enriches you. The things you know about Christ makes you not just an ordinary individual, makes you to become a supernatural individual. Because the Bible says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. That is, when you have the knowledge of Christ, your utterances, your knowledge, your talking, your ways, your knowledge will be different from every other one, because you are going to be talking divine. You are going to see things in the perspective of God. You are going to walk things in the ways of God. Do you know the problem we are having? Whosoever refuse to know about Jesus, whosoever do not accept Jesus and have the knowledge of Jesus, they live in darkness. The Bible made us to understand that this is the condemnation of the world, that the light is revealed unto the world. And because the children of men love darkness more than light, they rejected that. And because they rejected that light, it has become a condemnation to them. The appearance of Jesus to the world is not to condemn the world, but to reveal the light unto the world. When you accept that light, then you get the wisdom, you are enlightened, you become knowledgeable, your thinking, your planning, your goals, everything about you changes. As we are preparing to get into the new year, as we are making arrangement to get into the new year, let's think this in our mind and let's make it a priority in all that we go with the knowledge of Christ into the new year. You don't want to run the year without Christ. You don't want to be grouping in darkness, grouping in sadness, grouping in sorrow, grouping in sickness, grouping in anguish, grouping in vanquish, grouping in poverty, grouping in all these problems all through again. No. When you know him, you become a new creature. All things pass away. And by your knowledge of him, makes you to be loaded. When we say you are loaded, it means your wealth is growing so fast that whatever you are figuring out, you don't even know, you are never able to quite figure out how much fortune that you possess. With this word, you rule and control. In fact, in one area or the other, there are people we call the plutocrats. Now, these people we call plutocrats in the world, they are the people that, you know, have the wealth of the world. Great wealth. They have the opulence, the fortune, the power. They are the people that have the power to control the society, the community. You know, when you have this Jesus in you, when you have this Jesus in you, you become a plutocrat. You become a different thing entirely. Somebody who is completely new, because greater is he. You now begin to operate in the way that is quite different from just the common one. And God is not willing in any way. Look at it in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 7. So that you come short in no gift. That is the will of God. You don't come short in no gift. Eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is, everywhere you get to, you are manifesting Jesus. You are declaring Jesus. You are not coming short, because it is never the will of God that you come, and does not want you to have any shortage for you. God does not want to have any shortage for you. What do I mean by that? Never is it the will of God that you fall short. Never is it the will of God that you be inferior to your mates. Never the will of God that you are left behind. Never the will of God that you have a lack. Never the will of God that you come into a second place in your life. The moment you have Jesus, the moment you have him in your life, the moment you recognize his leadership, the moment you know who he is, then you begin to operate in that realm, and your role in life changes. What makes it to change? You continue to confirm the presence of this priceless gift in your community. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, the Bible says, "You are of God, little children, and you have overcome them. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." So that means when you make Christ to be in your heart, your demonstration of Christ is to be concrete. Anywhere you go to, you make it firm. Anywhere you go to, you are stable. Anywhere you go to, you are authentic. You are authenticating the presence of Christ. You are authenticating the might of God. You are verifying. You are giving a guarantee. You are making everyone to know that the coming of Jesus into the world is true. By the life you live, by the words you speak, by the wisdom you display, by the way you carry yourself, by the things that God is doing in your life, and you give it a testimony, and you give that testimony to the world in such a way that, you know, they scrutinize, they put Jesus on their scrutiny, and they look at it and they confirm it's true. When Jesus was on the cross, you know what they said? They said, "Truly, this is the Son of the living God." And that's exactly what God wants to prove in your life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 6, look at how they frame it in modern language. It says, "Everything you have heard and believed about Jesus Christ has been authenticated, proven beyond a shadow of doubt, verified and guaranteed to be true because of the gift of the Spirit." That means your life, it was the Spirit of God that manifested Jesus unto John the Baptist. And through that Spirit of God, John manifested him to the world, our duty, our calling as Christians is to manifest Jesus. And in this short time that we are dwelling together, brethren, I want you to understand that the Bible wants you, Jesus of the Bible, wants to step out of the pages of history. All the stories you have read about Jesus in the Bible, he wants to step out from the pages of that history and step into your life and into the life of the church. He wants to step in and then begins to manifest himself in real, as he demonstrated his life in the life of Paul, in the life of Peter, in the life of Stephen, in the life of all the apostles of old, in the life of John, when they carried him to that island of Patmos, and he was there communicating with heaven. He wants to demonstrate his life exactly like that in you. Let the beauty of Jesus be made manifest in our life. Let every one of us have it at the back of our mind that all through the rest of this year, we want to manifest Jesus. We want to know the real. We want to show the real to the people around us. We want to declare him. We want to make him known. We want everybody to know about our Lord Jesus Christ. As the Spirit of God is prompting you, asking you, talking about it to you, move out in faith and manifest Jesus. Show him to everyone you see. That is our reason for now. That is a priceless gift that God has given unto us. The breath of God inside of you makes you a living soul. And Jesus is the breath of life. You get it. You have him. He enters into your life. You have a new breath. He declared, he said, I'm the light of the world. He declared, I'm the bread of life. He declared, I'm the water of life. He declared, he is the Lord of life. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He's not only the Lord of the Jews or the Lord of anything. He's the Lord of the whole world. Every creature in the world is under him. And let's recognize that the rest of this year will manifest Jesus. Before Jesus, sicknesses depart. Before Jesus, storms depart. Before Jesus, troubles depart. Before Jesus, calamities depart. Before Jesus, sin departs. Before Jesus, every sorrow departs. Before Jesus, there is comfort. There is peace. There is joy. And Jesus provides all that for us. My brothers and my sisters, if you have not invited Jesus into your life as the year is running out, ensure that you invite him today. Let him come into your life. Let's have a word of prayer together now. And I want you to pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. I thank you for the power of making Jesus real to me. Oh Lord Jesus, help me to understand the need of the Spirit's gift. Oh Lord Jesus, arouse my spiritual gifts. Arouse the hunger inside of me to make me to experience more of you. Lord Jesus, I know you gave the Holy Spirit. Open my eyes so that I can understand and have the experience of the powerful Jesus. Lord Jesus, begin to flow into my life so that your flow into my life will flow into the whole world. Help me, Lord. Assist me, Lord. Give me grace to be all that you want me to be. Thank you, Father, because I know you have answered me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you because of the priceless gift you have given unto us. We thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost. We thank you for the manifestation of Jesus. We thank you because Jesus is the bread of life that has come into this life. Father, I'm praying as the year is going out. I pray as many as have not known you holistically and they have only known you historically. I'm praying that the manifestation of your power, the manifestation of your grace, we cancel their sins. We turn them to you. We make them your own. We turn them around and make them a new creature. Lord, I pray, cancel sin in their life. Father, I pray, cancel every satanic force in their life. The purpose of Jesus coming into the world, fulfill it in their life. The purpose of Jesus coming into the world to give peace, to give joy. He's the very water of life that woos out of the belly and flows and give peace to the people. Let that purpose be fulfilled in their lives. Lord, I pray every infection of the enemy, every problem of the wicked one, every operation of the wicked one, I pray that your power will cancel totally and completely in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray every sorrow that I be following the people, every difficulty that I be following there, every failure that I be following there, every adversity that I be following there, in the name of Jesus, the name above every name, let all those things cease to operate in their life. In the mighty name of Jesus, Almighty God, give them a testimony. Thank you, Eternal Father, because you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. Please share your testimony with us by writing a little comment on your Facebook. We'd like to hear from you. Don't forget, give us a call on 781-562-1389 or communicate with us on yeti.olu@gmail.com. God bless you. Have a blessed week. Bye-bye.